The controversy started 4 years ago when I presented a thought experiment at the 62nd annual meeting of the Institute of New Music and Music Education in Darmstadt, 2008, and my question was, which consequences will the new technologies have for new music? I was very surprised by the reaction of the public. Most of the speakers have been really upset by the speech, and only one composer, Orm Findahl, defended and supported the argument. So the text is translated into English. You find it on the website of the New Music Journal, Search. And I would like to read to you the first paragraph, which was meant to be a funny introduction. So in December 2006, in the Bundeskunsthalle in Bonn, the chess program Dietfritz defeated the reigning world champion, the Russian Vladimir Kremnik. After 6 games with a score of 42 points, the computer was able to win 2 games, while Kremnik only managed to reach a stalemate 4 times. For the chess world, this meant that the battle of man against machine was lost, and that in the foreseeable future, there would be soon be no one left who could even achieve a tie with the chess computer. But what does this historic caesura in the game of chess mean for music? So, this was, I thought, an entertaining introduction into the topic. But it raised some questions and disputes.
Yeah, in 2009, I published an article with the title "On the Current State of Contemporary Music." To be exact, it was quotation marks this current state. The first question was what is current state of material? That's in the quotation marks. Because what is material in music? Everyone uses this term, but it is not in any important dictionary. It is defined what material in music is. By the way, it's the same with the word structure. So I tried a materialistic definition that's not following Adorno, but simply saying that first of all it's the material of music, the sound of the instruments. This could be a possible definition, at least for me. I don't think that I can give a definition which everyone is using, but at least for me I wanted to find a definition. So first, it's in the instruments, that's a material of music. And the next question is, okay, what is the so-called state of material? This is this famous term by Adorno, which is describing the general state of the composer's mind in his age, which lies in this obscure material. So, okay, when I say it's the instruments, the material is the instruments, then the state of material is what kind of instruments are composers using? And the fact is that much more than composers, institutions define the instruments. At least that's how I experienced it. You get a certain instrumentation of an ensemble or for an actual project, and then you have to compose for this. So that's why I meant that institutions are composing, Institutionen komponieren, and to draw a solution was the digitalization, that this gives and then according to Vitaly Lehmann, already published before, that with the means of digitalization, composers become more autonomous in defining their sounds, their material.
Okay, so the controversy accelerated when the composer Klaus Stefan Mankoff criticized both positions of Greiber and mine in his paper "The New Technological Developments, Computer and Music." Mankoff's main accusation is that our argumentation is naive. He refers to the artificial research with the argument that new compositional programs will fail in the same way like there is no success in artificial intelligence. And second, it is wrong, he says, to speak about the digital revolution, because it suggests a very big change. And Monkov cannot see that the new digital technologies will have a huge impact for new music. The third point, which I reconstruct now, I suggested in my thought experiment that there will be virtual orchestras for new music. I call this virtual orchestras e-player, because one can, by the help of an e-player, not only record scores, but also compose with them. Klaus Stefan Monkow argued that it would be impossible to build such a virtual orchestra for new music, because you would have to record already for one instrument, for an oboe, 50 billion samples. Fourth, in analogy to the Photoshop program, with which one can manipulate any visual images, I suggested that there will be soon some soundtrack programs with which one can easily manipulate new music sound patterns like Euphonia, Texture, or a Klanggestalt from Lachenmann. Klaus Stefan Monkow again relates that such innovations are impossible or nonsense. The fifth point, Klaus Stefan Monkow rejects my main argument that a sociological argument is. Namely that the digital revolution would change the new music institutions. In his opinion, digital technologies do not at all change the production of scores, the education of composers, the form of new music concerts, and the compositional process. Sixth, in Monkow's opinion, all technological innovations which I describe have nothing to do with new music. And the last point, further, Monkow interprets the essay of Johannes Kreidler as a career strategy, but not as a serious argumentation. I think this is a root argument, or not an argument at all.
Then I replied to this text of Monkow. Now I have to say, it's a bit difficult that we are now describing this controversy from our side. Yeah. It would also be fair if Monkow was also sitting here. So this is our point of view, of course. Then please try to read on your own these texts, because of course we have our party. Okay, so I replied, digital naives or digital natives in the same magazine, Music Texte, that was in beginning of 2010. I was offended by Monkow, so I had to reply. Digitalization is a big theme for society, and there is obviously some a generation gap, not only a generation gap, but often it is, you can view it as a generation gap. And so this gap might also be in new music, for example, of ensembles, of creators, and aesthetically between a thought of structural composition and on the other hand a, say, postmodern or content orientated composition. So concretely that means I have three points with two institutions, for example publishing houses versus internet distribution. In my opinion, publishing houses are a dying culture. I don't really see what the need of a publishing house is anymore. The fact is that composers are making their scores and the publishing houses are only printing them out, more or less. But making scores expensive, etc. Then the second point, what Harry described, was the idea of using instrument samples, the so-called e-player, to compose or even to create kind of recordings out of them, or also to even use them for performance. What I was actually doing already since 2005, that I, for example, a piano piece which plays together with piano samples. Yeah. And with the samples you can all do all these things, like Mancarod it, and but it's not media sound, it's really high definition samples, which can be combined with a live piano that sometimes really cannot distinguish when listening to it. So that is controversial. I see the point that I'm using this simply, and I see the aesthetic potential of it. And the third point is algorithmic composition. That's how I described that there might be a sound shop software which is capable of imitating well-known new music styles. And I'm very sure that this is possible to the degree of how good style imitations can be. I don't think it's about that the computer is composing himself a masterpiece. We'll come to this point later. And the conclusion in general is there is a democratization of certain aspects of new music. And then, then we decided, okay, let's put this into a whole book, this controversy, on the initiative of the publisher Peter Mischel. So, okay, there was a publishing house, I have to admit.
Book publishing.
Yes, but it's about books, and, I am having this device, but still people are reading books. I read most of books there, but as long as people are reading the printed books, there are, of course, there can be publishing houses. I'm not against them. I simply see that there is a development that goes to another system. So then the controversy book was done in the middle of 2010 and published in August 2010. The book consists of these texts we already described, and we simply continued then the debate in the book itself. So there was then again the response from Markov to me, where Markov describes that I don't know if it's well known here, the so-called Riepel's law. Does anybody know this? Riepel's law means that cultural techniques never get abolished, or media never vanish, is the so-called Riepel's law, which I think is not true, because there are lots of media, for example, instruments that are no longer used, and we do not put things into stone anymore. We are using at least ink and paper. So, this thing about success, somehow Markov was arguing that I'm successful with some pieces, and with the help of YouTube, for example. And well, I think that it's not only a of course not. I mean, it's always in the arts, a success of a piece is combined with the success of a composer. That's simply the case. But Markov says that he's against remix. He really is against remix culture. This is obviously a generation gap. For him, this remixing is not art. He really says this. It's not art. And he is of course against changing anything about copyright laws, and he is against mixing art disciplines. He says a photo is a photo, a painting is a painting, etc. And his question back are, what is good about the internet and what is bad about it? He says, you are only looking on the good side, that there might be good aspects, but what about the bad aspects? Everything has all its bad aspects. What is an algorithm? What is the power of composition software? I think it's true that a lot of people simply don't know what is actually happening when algorithmic composition is being done. That's what I wanted to describe in my lecture tomorrow. Is this remix attitude postmodern or not? Are we talking about new material or about new contents? That were the questions of Markov. And my reply to that was, I think Riepel's law is not true. We don't carve text into stone, for example. I believe that books will more and more be replaced by ebooks. It might take another 20, 30, 40 years, I don't know, but it will happen, I'm sure about this. So publishing houses are a dying culture. I regret, maybe it's not good, but I think it's simply a fact. Or you could also see that Peter Ablinger, German composer, is also very successful on the internet. Here's one piece of him with his speaking piano, was viewed 500,000 times. So it's not meaningful to divide between a fast and a long enduring success, what Mayenkopf does. And I believe in remix culture, I believe we are all quoting all the time, because this process of material research has come to an end. There are no more instruments available, so he who writes for violin is copying, is what I'm saying. And I believe that immaterial property is something very different than material property, and ideas are not property. It is better for culture not to handle intellectual property like material property. And in my text, I'm describing then a composition software I was developing since a couple of years. That will be my lecture tomorrow. And I was describing a piece of mine called Charts Music, which was part of the debate because it's on the surface, this piece is pop music, since I used a pop composition tool. But I think it's new music, and I'm describing why, in terms of a shift to content orientation, this piece is new music, even though it's in a structural sense it is not not atonal music at least. Okay, then the second or the last answer of Mayenkopf. He doesn't see a big power in everything composition, and he is against my materialistic definition of material. He sticks to Adorno. He regards me as someone dealing with big data quantities, whereas he wants to concentrate on things. And he defends the copyright law. But he is definitely a cultural pessimist. A quotation by him is, the 68s became dictators, what will the internet anarchists become? And he doesn't believe in political music. It's really, really a bit hard to quote this, but yeah. Another quote by him: my concept of remix is like masturbation when viewing a couple having sex. And his conclusion: the digital natives are naive. Okay, then we didn't continue with this anymore. All points were set about in this direct confrontation. The book, the final section of the book was three texts by all three participants. So my text is called Traktat, which was a compound of several small texts. One is the text with the title Institutions Are Composing, where I'm again describing some examples where, in my opinion, institutions are much too much composing, where the real composers, they are only fulfilling the already existing concept, because the curators with their ideas, they are in fact the composers. Then a text called Text Installations, where I'm describing the problems of conception, that music becomes more conceptual, and so we need new concept forms. And the third text is titled Composing Means to Steal an Instrument. That's a variation of a sentence by Lanman. Yeah, where I'm describing a bit aggressive political aesthetic, and of course a remix aesthetic. Then the fourth text about composing and copyright law. I think this discussion is well known. The fifth is in the same direction, and then I have a bit of collection of aphorisms around the theme. For example, my sentence, he who writes for violin is copying. And the seventh text I'm describing is called Standard Situations. This debates about new technology have arisen in the whole mankind, there were people who say, we don't need it, it's not meaningful, etc. So I'm looking on a historical view on how these debates about new technology were in history. And the last text is called the Membrane Manifesto, which is a plea for new electronic instruments.
Okay, the title of Gustav Markov's article, What is the Avant-Garde? Quotes Adorno, who said that the idea of contemporary art is to making things that are impossible to make. With most of the statements I agree here, but only because they are very general assertions. The problem is not that the text refers to ideas of Adorno or Derrida, but that this conception of avant-garde doesn't confront the topic of digitalization at all. It is an avant-garde conception, as if the digital revolution doesn't take place, or at least doesn't matter. But of course, this position is consistent with the previous arguments of Gustav Markov, which suggests that the digital technologies are not a challenge for the new music system and don't have serious consequences for the self-understanding of a new music composer. The only reasonable position would be, from this perspective of Gustav Markov, to defend the status quo, because everything else would lead to a loss of the new music quality standards. So, I think
yes. And also a second text by Markov about hearing. He describes the joy and the erotic of listening, and that we always need the best instruments and the best electronics, not cheap software or devices, and not concerts. I mean, I enjoy listening, of course, very much, and I enjoy using very good instruments, etc. But there's also a point where I prefer an MP3 sound to a very, very good sound, because it can also become, a good sound can become boring. So for me, this attitude is a bit elitist, but well, new music might be elitist, that's for me not so much the point, but it's sentimental.
Okay. So in the last article of the controversy book, I worked out a theory which explained more precisely some ideas in the thought experiment. The biggest misunderstanding of the thought experiment has to do with the character of the argument. It is a sociological argument and insofar not common to the music scene. I never wrote that the new technologies will change immediately music concepts or music ideas. This would be, of course, a naive point of view. The argument is that the technologies shift social structures in which the new music is produced, distributed, and reflected. And only in the result of that transformation can the possibility of certain ideas and concepts of music to be accepted or rejected change. That infiltration and the use of the new digital technologies in the field of new music will lead to deinstitutionalization of the art system. That is my main argument, sociological argument. So, here you see already a slide from my next lecture, the infiltration of the use of new digital technologies in the field of new music will lead to a deinstitutionalization of the new music system. The theory describes the change from a strong institutionalized to a weak institutionalized social system, which implies a loss of institutional power. I will explain and discuss this in detail in the following lecture. Okay, this is for me too. Oh yeah, but the second part in this last article of the controversy book, I respond to Klaus Stefan Mankopf's argument that it would be impossible to build a virtual orchestra for the new music instruments. I made, by the help of Johannes Breitler, a calculation how many samples of an oboe one would have to record in order to get an e-player which one could use in the new music. So I came to the result, or we came to the result, that one doesn't need 50 billion samples, but only 80,000, and this is a quite possible number.
So that was the end of the book, but the controversy continued again in several magazines. For example, then the Swiss composer and sociologist Patrick Frank wrote an article, Controversy as Therapy, where he says, thanks for the controversy. And he again describes these two points, the shift to content orientation and the digitalization of music, and he says how they fit together. This new music has to be new, so it has to deal, for instance, with new technology. Interesting is that Frank refers to Jean Baudrillard's simulation theory. He says that a lot of new music nowadays is only a simulation of new music from the 60s and 70s.
Okay, and then Reinhard Böschläger, the publisher of Musiktexte, wrote an article with the title On the Digital Revolution. And as you see already in the headline, the word digital revolution is written with quotation marks, what indicates a certain distance of the author towards this notion. And indeed, Böschläger argues that there is no reason to speak in the context of the new digital technologies about a revolution. In his opinion, the whole notion digital revolution is an advertisement slogan in order to sell the new products which are based on the new technologies. Instead of the notion digital revolution, he suggests to speak about a digital evolution. In respect to Johannes Kreidel, he says it would be okay if Kreidel would use the word digital revolution in a private sense as his own compositional aesthetics, but Böschläger criticized the general pretension as if the digital revolution is a historical process or fact which will have consequences for other composers too. At the end, he says that Johannes Kreidel must believe in the same way like the surrealists in a historical progress. And here I responded, I think, in the article Positionen, I think the argumentation of Böschläger is very illustrative, but it misses the point. So therefore I wrote a response in the new music journal Positionen under the headline On the Concept of Digital Revolution. Is the use of the terminus digital revolution justified? That was my question. We do not call the Neolithic Revolution some 8,000 years ago and the Industrial Revolution in the 18th century a revolution because of a single technological innovation like the plow or the steam engine, but because of the complex social implications of such innovations. And in the same way, I would be justified to speak about a digital revolution if the digital technologies change our way of life and work like the steam engine did 200 years ago. I think this is exactly the case, especially do the new digital technologies change the social structure in the new music system. Insofar, we do not observe a digital evolution like Böschläger suggested, but a digital revolution.
Orm Finnendahl, composer and professor for electronic music in Freiburg, Germany, he is a former teacher of mine, he wrote also in the same issue, Positionen, an article. He is surprised that this discussion, which was present 20 years ago in other disciplines, now arises in new music, but better late than never. And about the term digital revolution, not evolution, but revolution. He says then, digitalization goes back to the ancient times. Already the calendar is a digital description of the movements of Earth, Sun and Moon. And then he goes very deep into the theory and philosophy of digitalization and computerization. The abstraction of data into digits, into zeros and ones. This process of abstraction this model should be regarded with its aesthetical implications, not only the surface of digital sounds or better notation software. He sees three consequences. First, it's comparable to the publishing houses. the studios for electronic music are less important nowadays, since composers can work more autonomously on their laptop at home. And the internet changes our perception due to this masses of available music, and the computerization in general forces institutions to focus on that.
Okay. So in this article, Klaus Stefan Mankopf responded, so the controversy continued, to my text about deinstitutionalization, which I published in the controversy book at the end. I interpret this text as a misreading of my sociological argument on purpose. But as always, the messenger of the bad news is blamed for the message. Klaus Stefan Mankopf links my sociological theory of deinstitutionalization to a position of neoliberalism. It is, of course, not an argument, but pure polemic. At the end, Klaus Stefan Mankopf speaks about such right-wing figures like Silvio Berlusconi and Jörg Haider and makes thereby some implicit connection to the theory of deinstitutionalization. So, this polemic is based on a categorical failure. I describe and reconstruct an objective social process which one could only stop by destroying the internet and all computer-based technology. Klaus Stefan Mankopf reads my theory as a normative theory, as I would provide the political concept which justifies deinstitutionalization of the new music culture. What is wrong? But as I said, in my opinion, the deinstitutionalization is a social process which is triggered by the digital technology and has, for different participants of the new music system, different consequences. For some participants, it is a positive development, and for other participants, it is a negative development.
Then, Volker Strebe, a musicologist and professor at the Electronic Studio of the Technische Universität in Berlin, he also published an article in Musiktexte, pre-digital consciousness. The same sentence did like Finnendahl, this discussion comes much too late. He says digitalization is already over, which was supposed to be a provocation. I disagree. He replies mostly not to both of us, but to Mankopf. For example, he is describing the loudspeaker music, that it also has performance qualities due to the concert hall, due to the mixing on the desk, for example. And he says that Mankopf has no idea about media music and conceptualism, but then shouldn't call himself a music theorist. And Strebe says that Mankopf is typical for the whole new music scene, which is very conservative, in Strebe's opinion. They stick to old forms of music playing, old instruments, old concert situation, whereas in his opinion, sound art is the new music. Then there was a radio discussion between Mankopf and me, and moderated by Björn Gottstein, musicologist, which was a one-hour discussion with almost all points in it, and yeah, we concretized it on specific works, especially on my piece, Charts Music, what I described before, kind of pop music piece, a YouTube video, in fact, which was quite successful. It was viewed over 500,000 times. And on the other side, Mankopf's Peinchen Cycle. It's hard to summarize now this radio discussion. I would say not really new thoughts came up. Then the text later was also published again, the transcription of the discussion.
Okay, and then the composer Thomas Hummel joined the controversy. He starts his article, Necessity as a Driver of Innovation, which is published in the Swiss journal Dissonance. So he starts his article with a remark that he is very inspired by the controversy and would like to give a practical example for deinstitutionalization. in your music. So he wrote an 1 hour long orchestral piece with the name Austrahila for 22 instrumentalists and a speaker, but there was no real chance for him to get the piece ever performed. So he knew this. So Hummel recorded every single voice from hundreds of such small samples. He afterward compiled the piece on his computer together. The recording was published as a CD, and instead of 20,000 euro, which a normal recording would cost if the piece have to be rehearsed and played by a real orchestra, Hummel paid only 2,700 euro for musicians, plus some months of his own working time on the computer. After Thomas Hummel could substitute the institutions of the orchestra by computer technology, he even got a live performance, but only because he has had already produced a virtual CD.
With orchestra you mean ensemble?
Ensemble, yeah, but he wrote it really for orchestra for 22
instruments, I don't know.
Okay, but I think he speaks about orchestra, for orchestra, yes, in the audience. Okay. So in the meantime, Thomas Hummel, I think last month or in September, he published a virtual orchestra for new music, and there is even an e-player available there. So you can go to the website Contimbra and buy the product.
And recently a book of mine is published, Music with Music, where there is again a new text of mine entitled CoIT, which is an acronym for Calculated Objects in Time. That's my software, which I will explain tomorrow. So now what can a composition software nowadays really compose? And in this text I wanted to concretize a lot of what was discussed before abstractly, but I will talk about this tomorrow, where I will describe in detail this software.
Okay, last December I published in the Swiss New Music Journal Dissonance the article Digital Infiltrations, and here I started to use for the first time Michel Foucault's concept of dispositive for the controversy, and I will talk about this topic later in the lecture. And in response to this article wrote Stefan Hetzel in the Bad Block of Music an article which summarizes and highlights some of my arguments. The blog is a blog of the new music journal Neue Musikzeitung, and this article is a good example that today intelligent observers from outside of the new music scene, which some years ago would probably have no access to such a discussion, have now a voice in the discourse. An analogy with the work of Thomas Hummel is this another example for a deinstitutionalization and a democratization process of this art scene.
And in addition, there was, for example, also in Darmstadt 2010 a panel at the end of the Darmstadter Ferienkurse with Orm Finnendahl, Björn Gottstein, and me, where we talked with the public and discussed about digitalization. And very similarly, a year later, also in the Experimentalstudio in Freiburg with almost the same people. For me, interesting was, we didn't talk about this, that was what Markov said, that, okay, it might be the case that computers or general machines, they are making things easier for us. But that's bad for arts, that's bad for composition, and you won't have to work hard. If it's too easy, that cannot be good for the arts. Orm Finnendahl said that for him, due to digitalization, in fact, composing becomes much more difficult. And again, someone from the audience said that the whole discussion was led in the pop world already 10 years ago. I have to say, yes. Some people say this, and I always ask, okay, please give me this text about it. But no one could then show me really this text about such a discussion. So at least in the music arts world, in the new music world, this discussion wasn't led, but it has to be. And, well, I'm a composer, so in 2010 I made a music theater piece, Fietz Hören Sie Fahr, which was a new music talk show, you could say. So I decided, why not including it in the theater piece. So this controversy was a splendid material, and so I created a scene with a fictive dialogue with the inventor of the MP3 codec. We transformed the talk live into very bad MP3 sound, and I took then the role of Mankov and quoted sentences of Mankov's from the book. You can watch this scene on YouTube.
So in August and September this year, there have been two radio transmissions which referred to the controversy on top of new media and another radio transmission about new music and philosophy. So, and in the last 2 years I wrote this book, The Digital Revolution of Music, A Philosophy of Music, which will be published by Short Music in October of this year, and I would like to invite you and to present you in detail this book in the lecture I will give after a short break. Thank you.